pace, my sister. Thank you for joining the class and welcome. I am extremely informal and I hate doing videos, actually. So I'm always worried about how I look and what's the lighting and did I say the right thing at the right time and all that sort of stuff. And so I'm just gonna block that out. And so I just prefer being just super informal. So I'm going to record this just to kind of give you a synopsis of the reading that I've done, of the body scan that I've done, and let you know what's been told. And then from there, I'm just gonna discuss some of the spiritual anatomy and work with that. And from there, I'm going to make a separate video for you because I've already been told which yoga set that you'll need for this week. And it's going to be something very light. I have a meditation for you and a yoga set. And you're going to do both of those for the next few days until it's time for the next video. So, okay, well, you've read my book, so you do know some of my story, you know, some of kind of what yoga has done for me and my process and healing and things like that. So just to give a little bit more of an introduction about myself, I shared this in another video also, but I have a type of spirit that, like, part of my destiny purpose for coming here was to just experience all things. So I have this kind of ability to not really judge situations and just to kind of be wide open to things and open to new experiences and to just feel them and feel what they are and live them. And then also when certain experiences happen, also how to replenish or how to return to the state of, to that central state of being after certain experiences, because there are experiences that uplift us and expand us and make us grow into somebody else. And that needs its own type of rebalancing as we shift and rise into a new being and a new person. And then there are the kind of experiences that damage us and break us and traumatize us. And there's a different type of energy that is needed in order to rebalance from those experiences. And I have, unfortunately, being so wide open to everything, have had a life that has been full of trauma and damage. And I have had a lot of experience with putting the pieces back together after going through things. And I definitely consider myself, unfortunately, to be a master of that. I've also had some amazing experiences too. Thankfully, you know, I would consider them at this point to be balanced, but I have had some pretty severe traumas, and as physical injuries, even such as like the car accident, like what you went through. I've been in a severe car accident. I've had a skiing accident. I've had, you know, just different physical traumas, but then also emotional traumas, you know, like grief and loss, you know, the loss, my mother died, my best friend died. And just dealing with, you know, and having to process, just I've had to learn to process those things. A lot of the trauma that I've experienced nearly made me want to leave here. And the reason I'm still here is because I use methods and because I'm connected to the ancestors and connected to the deities who brought me here, who are my guardians. And regardless of whatever happens, our connection is and our bond is so tight that even when I'm done, they still sustain me and they provide a connection to me to be able to learn a new way to hold on and to thrive and then to stand up and then to increase and to continue to expand my being and open to my destiny. So, I did the reading on you, and interestingly, your body does not particularly have a negative, like a specific trauma story to tell. A lot of people's bodies have trauma stuck inside them where there are blockages. So it seems either there are two possible situations here. Either your body has suppressed some of the block and it's not ready to rise it up and to speak about it just yet. Like maybe there are other things on top. For example, because of the actual trauma going on in your body from the accident, there is like it's like a noise. Like, so if you can imagine, so when I'm listening to your organs, when I speak to people's organs, their organs tell me very direct and very complete stories about what's going on in them. Sometimes somebody's lungs will tell me stories about, you know, a childhood trauma or grief that a person had, and their lungs are telling me the story. And the person's like, wow, how did you know that that happened to me? And I'm like, well, your lungs told me. And it sounds odd to people who have not experienced that or are not aware that our organs are living and alive and they're part of our human process too. So sometimes people can be kind of blocked off or think that's weird, but all of our body parts are all alive and conscious. Every single cell is alive and conscious and speaks to us, and they all speak to each other. They tell a story, and the story that they are told manifests as what we in the West, you know, label as these disease labels, but there are no disease labels. There are imbalances or conversations that go on between our organs and between all of our body, our skin, our bones, our hormonal system, our lymphatic system, our circulatory, the heart, the lungs, the kidneys, the liver, the spleen, the pancreas, the brain. All of these are telling stories to each other and ask, oh, I need this right now. Can you send me some of this? And, oh, you know, hey, I got a little too much of this. Who can help me? I need to dump this off. And all of the things we experience from out here, from our consciousness that we think is out here, is the process of all of those stories going on inside of us. And we're just kind of like along for the ride of what our actual body is doing until we tune in and connect to it. So back to, you know, to your recent incident, it's possible that there may be some other things that are locked in your body underneath, but the sound of the trauma that's going on in your body from the accident, the pain that you're experiencing and things like that, is louder than whatever other story that your body might be trying to tell at the moment. Right now, your body is so busy focused on talking about that, it's not talking about any other situation. So I obviously, you know, for each session, I still will do a reading and a body scan and re-examine what's happening with you and how your body is progressing and how it feels about that progress. So, but for now, it doesn't have. The only thing that it did tell me was that you have an imbalance in the throat area and that you have trouble expressing what you really want to say comfortably, that you have like maybe a guilt, a guilt that sticks with that, or an uncertainty that comes with being direct or saying exactly what you mean and feeling like you'll be heard without kind of any kind of, you know, any negative consequence or any tension or anything like that. So that's just something that your body said. That may be also an old issue, or that may be a temporary issue that's come up while you're dealing with this. So we can, that's something we can talk about, and you can give me more information about what, you know, what your throat area is trying to say. And then so back to your physical trauma. So we're going to work on that first. The most important thing for you now is actually to get through that sound. So as I was saying, so it's kind of like when you're on the phone and if there's like, you know, so you're talking to somebody and it's super windy and they're saying words and you can hear the words underneath, but the wind is blowing so hard in the phone that you could really kind of just hear the wind. And that same, almost even to that same sound of like when you're talking to somebody on a cell phone and where they are is really windy, the sound, the conversation your body is giving off right now sounds like that wind blowing into the phone when you're trying to hear somebody. It's kind of like that. So there's a lot of sharp energy that's bouncing back and forth really quickly because different parts of your body are holding pain, trying to dump the pain, but they're dumping the pain on another place that's trying to dump pain. So it's like a different points that keep bumping into each other. And that's part of what's causing the problem. So the harmonious flow of energy that needs to move outward and down through your body is not happening in its proper form right now. So let me just back up and go over spiritual anatomy some. And once we get the spiritual anatomy understood, then we can start to work on. I'm going to give you the first set that I was given to for you to work with, for you to, because what we want to do first is actually to open you up to having a conversation with your body and finding out who is speaking and what are they saying to each other. And so you need to be participating in that conversation. So the yoga set that I'm going to give you is a very simple set. It's not easy, but it's simple. It's just going to be like a one posture set, as opposed to, because a lot of Wajet yoga is all about movement and breathing. There's a lot of movement. It's not a still sit in a posture, hold it, be in it, feel it. It's not that kind of yoga. It's based on movement, because movement is life and life force. So in the natural process of a woman, so that one of the whole points of this being a woman's wellness series is because our woman's spiritual anatomy is different. Let me tilt this a little bit because I want you to be able to see as much of me as you're able. A woman's physical anatomy is designed differently than how men's are. So there are some things that we have in common. So basically, you know, we all have an aura. That's our light radiating out from all the movement that takes place in our all of our mixed of energy fields. So we have our aura, and then we have in the center, we have our chakras. And this is, again, it's a debatable point whether some people say we have 11, some people say we have 9, some people say we have 7, and some people say it depends on what race you are or what culture or things like that. Regardless, we know that there are chakras that are aligned, there are different energy points, and the main energy points, regardless of whether there are more or that amount, the main energy points that there are actually completely align with the different hormonal systems in our body. So all of the places in our body where hormones are produced and emitted and sent into the bloodstream all have chakras there. So that's a really important thing to also know, just in the physical and metaphysical connection of the body. So we have our aura, we have our chakras that are aligned along the spinal pathway, and we have an arc line which goes up here. It goes up over the top of the head from ear to ear, and this arc line is made of a different light form, the texture of the light. It's kind of like how electromagnetic radiation or solar radiation, there are different types of radioactive material. So the light that makes up the aura is made of a different type of light than the one that makes up this here. And so this is what's the halo that's been so commonly shown in ancient writings and ancient pictures. That is what that is. So this here, this arc line that goes from here to here, is very bright when we are fully connected to our Ka, Ori, to that which is our guardian, the guardian who guides us through our life. So we have a deity, a being, who stays with us and who helps to guide us through our life. And this here is our connector point to that deity. And we also have here, there's like a disc-shaped light. It's almost like a record, like a vinyl record. It's like slid in right here, right in the heart center. It's a circular disc of light, and it has an arc line, and it comes out here. So it comes out from, in women, it sticks out from nipple to nipple. And this is one area this arc line is something specific to women's spiritual anatomy. Men do not have this. And this is part of our bonding experience, how we nurture children. This is responsible for us having the capacity to be so open, which is in a natural, healthy woman and a natural, healthy man. This is what gives women the capacity to be kind of like open and receptive to a man, open and receptive to children, to the needs of others around her. This is all part of a reading, a message that's being read and shared back and forth right here in this arc line. So when the arc line is not pure, so when we've been through shock, trauma, whether it's physical, emotional, mental, spiritual, the arc line becomes shattered. The arc line can get little breaks in it. And then eventually, if we have either like major trauma or if we have continued steady trauma, the arc line will become shattered. And so what the arc line is the electromagnetic radiation that comes off of the heart. So the heart reads the story in all of the body. So all of your cells in your entire body, all 3 trillion of your cells have messages that they're giving off all the time. And what the heart does is send messages, and this is scientifically proven. This is something that is a new branch of science, a new part of cardiology, is understanding the further mechanisms of the heart and actually what its functions are. So the heart actually sends out a signal that's like sonar to every cell in your entire body, and it gets a reading off of every cell in the entire body and then gathers up the whole reading and then stores that reading in your arc line. So this whole center here is like the receptacle, the messenger, the message holder of all of the information that your heart receives. So with each beat, with each wave that it sends out a wave, and it picks up all the information, brings it back, and it stores it here. So if there is anything going on in the body, the heart is always, always, always affected by anything going on in the body. Now what the heart does, once it gathers that information about what's happening to the body, it picks up that information and stores it in the arc line and then feeds it out from the arc line, feeds it out into the aura. So whatever story is going on in our body, that story gets retold into our aura, And our aura is responsible for us interacting with the world around us, to attracting to us the things that we need, for repelling the things we don't need. So depending on what story the physical body is telling the heart, that completely decides what story the heart is telling to the aura. So whatever is being told to the aura is helping to shape our reality. So it is extremely, extremely important that this area of the body stays clean. And one of the things that we suffer as women today is that this area is so damaged because we have ancestral trauma that's stored there. We have childhood trauma that's stored there. We have the trauma from interacting with other people who are experiencing trauma. And as we draw their energy into us and store it there, we're carrying around so much energy that could possibly be negative, depending on our circumstances, depending on our environment. So it is extremely important to keep this space clean. It's important to go through a cleansing process, and it should be done rhythmically, kind of, you know, something that's like on a monthly basis. But you know, again, we're going through a major cleansing now. We're going to clean our way up to the equinox, and once we arrive at the equinox, from there, with that space of cleansing and that receiving the earth energy in alignment, we can actually go forward from there. From all of us who are participating in this course, we can go forward from the spring equinox and start to develop that rhythm, that cleansing rhythm, so that the heart always helps to get everything processed through, processed and cleaned. So in the woman's body, what happens here? So the heart center absorbs all this energy, and it takes this energy and it presses it down through all of the digestive organs here, and it goes in, you know, through and between and everything, so it's energetic information. And it goes down to the womb where it gets stored, and then it gets flushed out. And this happens obviously physically, and it happens energetically as well. So the energy goes to the heart, it's stored here. Anything that needs to be processed out goes down. So there's a rhythmic flow. So it's so you kind of have this disc here spinning like a vinyl record, moving here, absorbing information, you know, moving in the field, and anything that's not needed in the field, and the same thing, the same way that the heart has that beat. As it squeezes, and it can just press the things downward. So rhythmically, things are moving out of our body, moving downward and outward that no longer serve us, that don't serve this heart line, this heart space here. And so there are different things that can cause blockages for that heart space. So when we eat poorly and we keep our physical body clogged up, when we keep the intestines clogged up, the information that's trying to slide downward through our cells, through the natural space that's between the cells, that doesn't happen because it's clogged. So in the clog, it will start to find new ways to shift. But if it can't find ways to shift around and go down, it will end up getting stuck in different places, getting held, and it will have to find a new way. So sometimes it gets stuck in different organs, and then that's when we develop problems with organs. Some people get it stuck in their kidneys, some in their liver, people in their pancreas, and then we have things developing like diabetes or alcoholism from people trying to do, you know, overdo certain things with their liver, or having, you know, kidney failure or dialysis. And what they don't recognize a lot of times, especially for us as women, is that what those actually are manifestations of is that our heart center is struggling to cleanse itself, and we're not giving it the free, open, moving space to clean itself out completely. And so all of these things, these build up, this residue eventually becomes physical, and then it becomes a part of our physical process. And in the process of it being physical, that's our key. That's our body talking to us. The body is telling a story. When the kidneys say, you know, there's no dialysis before the kidneys have been complaining for a very long time that something is wrong. There's no alcoholism before the liver has been complaining for a very long time that something's wrong. You know, there's no diabetes before the pancreas has been complaining for a long time that something is wrong. So again, it's extremely important that we listen to these stories that the body is saying, to listen to these conversations. So the energy outward, downward. And so in my own personal story, I had issues with my liver. So I would drop the energy down, the energy would, because I had a lot, I had an extremely traumatic childhood. I've actually had a good deal of trauma over the course of my life, but in childhood especially, there were some serious traumatic incidents, including the death of my mother and childhood sexual abuse, things like that. And so that caused my arc line to shatter. So in the way that it broke, instead of the energy moving rhythmically downward and outward as it was supposed to, it's like a broken mirror. Like, light doesn't reflect off of a broken mirror the same way. So it shattered, so it would like go down toward my liver, go down toward other organs. And for me, the liver was the organ most able to handle the shattering, the constant banging of energy in the wrong direction. So the liver held it, so then my liver developed problems. So then the liver was trying to dump off its excess energy that it wasn't supposed to be receiving, so it started dumping it down onto my ovary. And that's what I explained in the book about in my own healing process, using the Wajet Yoga to heal my ovary, the tumor that I had in my ovary. When I had to listen to my body's story and conversation, that's what I actually found out. That's what was going on. So there was grief, tension, and shattering here, which was dumping energy down here, which was knocking energy over here, and where it was getting stuck, because that was its last point, its last exit point before it leaves the body. And it was getting stuck there because it was not, the energy was dumping off too much and in the wrong direction, wrong vibrational flow for it to receive it and process it properly. So my poor ovary was just going through a time with that. And I want to say also, one of the most beautiful things, one of the most beautiful parts of going on a healing journey naturally, is that you actually come to know you. You actually come to know who you are. And when we talk about in the conscious community and things like that, talking about knowing who we are, we talk about like history that's over there, and talk about culture that's over there, and talk about all these other still external factors about who we are and who we are. And even when we get to the who we are, we still look at all these external factors of who we are. Who are your parents? How do you treat your siblings? All this other stuff. And then we come to the mental, but we still never come fully into ourselves. Like, who are you? Nobody ever asks themselves that question. Nobody ever asks that question to their own body. Who are you? Who are you? What is your story? What are you here for? What are you trying to tell me? What do you want me to do for you? What are you here to do for me? People don't ask that. And if they do, then it sometimes it's still a kind of like a metaphysical sort of visualize the body doing this and imagine the body doing that. But we don't need to visualize and imagine. This is real. This is like the realest thing you have. People talk about, the pyramids and the Sphinx and all these things and how we know our ancestors because it was proof and they left everything in proof. There is nothing really. I have with my own bare eyes, I have never laid my bald eyes on the pyramids. But the only thing that I can absolutely guarantee that I have, because I'm experiencing it every moment, is my own physical being. And that own physical being is the last place that we ever speak to. This is the realest thing that we have in our existence, and it is the one thing that we almost completely ignore. So even when we're taking Western medication, like when we take a pill, a pain pill, or take some, a sleeping pill or a menstrual pill, like whenever we just take stuff and just take it, it's like an insult to the body to ignore the process, because the body is talking to you. Like, if we had to imagine our body as an elder, because it is an elder. Your body is an elder. Your body holds all of your DNA ancestry, especially as women. We have the mitochondrial DNA to trace all the way back to the first woman that walked the planet. All of that story is here, just in our DNA, in that teeny little microchip, that teeny little thing of our DNA. If you unraveled it, you'd have to put mountains of them together to even see it on the head of a pin. And yet that story is telling our story all the way through humanity, back to our very origins. And so you can imagine, just in our DNA is telling all that. All of your cells are telling the story. Your cells are telling your parents' story. Your cells are telling the story from your birth, all the way from your pre-birth, from your fetal stage. Your cells are still telling the story of who you are and what happened. They're just telling the story of who you really are. And we need to listen. So when we sit down with our body and we speak to our body like an elder. What do you have to tell me? What do you have to teach me? What have we been through together? What's our story? It's just like if you sit down, like when I was a little girl, my mother's side of the family is from North Carolina, and I can remember going out to visit some of our family who lived way out in the country, and sitting on the porch. You know, I had this one uncle, and I was little. I was must have been about 5 or 6, and I just had this one uncle who I just really liked. He just used to sit in this rocking chair and just rock back and forth, and he wasn't a man of many words. He wasn't, you know, one of those silent men or anything like that, like of that few words, but he didn't say much unless he had something to say. So he was my Uncle Jasper. Uncle Jasper would sit in his rocking chair and he would rock back and forth. And I remember my mother, I'd be on the porch playing with my little like toy cars, those and the matchbox cars and things. So I'd be on the porch rolling my little cars together. And my mother and my auntie and my Uncle Jasper would all be sitting there, and he would just say things. And the way he said them was just so profound. And I would stop sometimes. And even as a little girl, like I couldn't really always understand the grown-up conversation, but there was like this sense of what Uncle Jasper was saying was something significant and it meant something. Cause even the way my auntie and my mother would look at him like, with that kind of like, I could feel them learning, you know, off of the things he was saying. And so I just really like that. And whenever I think of having conversations with my body, I remember my Uncle Jasper, you know, in his rocking chair, just leaning back and saying profound things just out of nowhere, just, you know, just being a wise old black man, and that was it. And our body is that. So when we would sit down at the feet of your own body and ask humbly, like, hey, you know, teach me something. What do you have to say, Uncle Jasper? Tell me, Grandpa, what's going on? Speak to me, Grandmother, you know, and let the body tell its story to you, because everything that you need to become is based on who you are and what you have. So without fully knowing that, there is no way of fully living your destiny. You know, people, everybody in my family is all in the healing arts. My stepmother is a psychiatrist, my father is a psychologist, my sister is a social worker, I have a brother who's a behavioral therapist, and all of us through our way all have our, it's about healing modalities, and so it's about all this healing process, this mental healing process. And one of the things that I always found was that trying to heal the body through the mind is extremely limited, because number one, it's limited by our conditioning. Number one, whatever we think we're supposed to think, that we're going to think it. Whatever we've been told to think, or how we feel about ourselves, how we view ourselves, perceive ourselves, affects what it is we allow ourselves to think. So when it comes to healing, if you say, I am going through this, and oh, but going through that is not a good thing. Oh, you know, good people don't go through that, or spiritual people don't go through that. We have a program. So the programming completely interrupts the healing process, because now you've gotten to the truth, but now you just came along and just erased the truth, because your mind doesn't want to believe that based on some previous conditioning. Now the difference is with the body doesn't ever lie, ever. The body is incapable of lying. So if you really want to know the truth of who you are and what's really going on, and you really truly want to heal, the greatest healing modality that I've ever found is this yoga. And because all for me, and I'm good for overthinking things, and for trying to make logic out of things and trying to find some other way around if I don't like what I'm hearing, I'm good for that. Even when I try not to be that, my mind will still just spin. But when I go through healing where I just, who cares what you think, and literally just go through the body and allow it to tell its story, allow it to work its process, I heal, I change, and I grow, I expand, I get better, and it's completely different. So it's a very big deal for me to be able to use physical means as the expression, as the modality of healing. It's fantastic. I love this. Okay, so I've explained basically, you know, the basics on the body process, and I think, let me see how much time we got there. Okay, what I'm gonna do is actually make the video for your yoga set separately. I'm gonna make the meditation separately and the video, and I'm gonna send you links to this and also to both of those. Now, one of the key places in your body that this the vehicle injury has caused trauma to is to your coccyx bones, those like last little 5 bones at the tailbone. And so whatever injury that you're experiencing up your spine, anything in your spine, and even in the upper part of your neck, you may be feeling the pain directly to the coccyx, or it may be that the coccyx is like slanted or something where it's where the shift that it's that you're having to hold your body in may be placing the pain sensation somewhere else. But the origin point of the pain, the part that was actually damaged that's causing the problem, is actually in the coccyx. So I'm going to give you a meditation and a yoga set, that's going to help you to hear that and help you to hear where, you know, where these little shifted stories, where this kind of energy, this sharp energy that's banging around in you, is all kind of coming from, and what your body wants in order to balance it. So let me see. I'm trying to think if there was anything else I wanted to share with you. I think that's it. And so I'm going to leave the video here. I absolutely would like you to be able to, I'm going to send you my number. I would like you to be able to reach out to me at any time. Call me. I'm most easily to reach by text or by, you know, by inbox or whatever, because I'm always on the go and things like that. So it's easier. So I can always get back to you if you have any other questions. If you have WhatsApp, I use WhatsApp, and you can always leave voice notes there if you have something kind of longer to say and you don't want to text back and forth, but you know, or you don't have time for a conversation at that point, or you have a thought you wanted to just get out of your head or a question to throw out. I can connect you through WhatsApp, because I have a WhatsApp group for this healing, for this. I think I'm going to leave it there. And thank you again. Thank you so much for supporting my works. And also, I'm really glad that you're on this healing journey with us. And we will be in touch. And I will speak to you soon, my sister.